Then we are starting the topic right from the director. The complete name of this chapter, we can put it out, director. And this topic, director, has got to be divided into three parts. And if we are talking about the BEREC, then as per BEREC, the topic director has got to be divided in three parts, that chapter number 11, 12, and chapter number 13. See, we have to see section 149 to 172 in this chapter number 11, and each and every provisions concerned with the appointment of director. Apart from that, what should be the qualification of director? What should the director, or disqualification of the director? These certain kinds of provisions have got to be covered under section 149 to 172. And apart from that, along with this, these sections, we have to see this rule as well. What the name of the rule called here? Companies Appointment and Qualification of Directors Rule 2014. And whenever we are talking about the form, then we shall file the form with the ROC. This form name called form DIR. It may be 1, it may be 2, it may be 3, it may be 4. It means the form series will go that, you know, right, DIR form there. After that, we should be moving on to the section of 173 to 195. 173 to 195, the basic provisions are there, which concerns, all the provisions are concerned with, of course, the power and duties of the director. Apart from that, section 173 to section 175 concerned with the board meeting. And very relevant provisions, all the relevant provisions we have to see here, all these provisions are concerned with the management, you know, this one. And the rule will go, that's Companies Meeting of Board and its Power Rules, what it called that, you know, MBP Rules 2014. And form series, that's MBP form there. And chapter number 13, that's required to see section number 196 to 205. Here the provisions concerns with the remunerations, what you may say, that appointment of managing director, whole team director, such kind of provisions are there under section 196 to 205. After that, we shall finish this topic, director. And right from today's to almost 15 classes, we shall have to focus onto the provisions of director. Each and every provisions we have to focus very properly. In this particular chapter number 13, I mean to say that we have to see this rule, what the rule name called here, Companies Appointment and Remuneration of Managerial Personnel Rules 2014, and the form series will go that MR form there. See, before starting this chapter, starting this chapter number 11 here, as per my course in chapter number 1, we have to see what is the director and what's the need for the director. Apart from that, we have to see that how the director shall be appointed, who shall appoint the director, what's the qualification of director, what's the disqualification of director, which kind of director is required to be appointed by the company. All these matters we are going to find out here. Before starting this chapter, I must share a story with you. Suppose that this is a person name called Raju. This one, that's person name called Raju. Now the Raju is grown up. He has just completed his education. Now he is coming to his father and saying that, father, give me a certain amount so that I can start my business. Please give me certain capital. Father says, okay, no problem, I'm giving you the amount. The father has given him rupees 5 lakhs so that he could start his own venture, own business. Now what the Raju is doing that? Raju had just started a mobile shop in which he was just selling the mobiles of different brands there. Now he wants certain expansion, but he needs the fund. Now the father is not willing to help him because father has also got some other sons. What the Raju should do in that situation? Raju meet up with a friend that's called Monu. Now there is two person Monu. Raju says to Monu, Monu, you please make the investment in our business, in my business. I will make you the partner. I will give you, of course, the sharing of the profit. Monu says, okay, no problem. I am just making the investment on this business. Then now the total capital comes 5 lakhs invested by Monu, 5 lakhs invested by Raju. Now the total capital comes 10 lakhs. Now the business is going into the well manner. Business is just flowing day by day. Now again they want to make certain expansion as well. The fund is required here. Then what they will do that? Now what they will do that? They are just going to its some relative that may be the auntie, that may be the uncle, that may be the what you may say it, you know, cousin, brother, whatever. They have contacted to these people and says that you please make the investment into the business and I will give you the sharing of the profit. But they says that will you let us participate into the management of the company? Raju and Monu says that no, we don't let you participate into the management of the company because management shall be run by us, you know. Then okay, no problem, we are making the investment, but we must share the profit properly. The deal is final now. The deal is final. If you want to do this business in a very particular recognized manner, so that no cheating could take place into the future, and there would be of course a certain platform in which the management would be separate and honor would be separate, you know, in that very case you have to start a company. Till here there was the partnership, and owner and the person involved in the management are the same person. That's why there is no chance of having any kind of dispute. But here, this one, these three people are also the owner, but they won't participate into the management, you know. Only these two people, that's Raju and Monu, will run the management. Since they are running the management, they shall be considered as, of course, the director of the company. They shall be considered as the director of the company. Apart from that, if Raju and Monu want some more expansion of the business, they need more fund. They need more fund. They want to establish its own factory, its own workshop, so that the mobile could be manufactured of its own brand. In that very case, there is need of huge funds, you know. Then what they will do that? If it is in the company form, they will come with the initial public offer. They will come with the initial public offer. These people would be the shareholder of the company. Again, these two people are in the management of the company. The person who are in the management of the company, as per the Companies Act, these persons are called as, of course, the director of the company. See, as per the situation, this Raju and Monu properly been appointed as the director of the company. Properly. They have got to be appointed as the director of the company. But this uncle, he has also got a huge investment into the company. This auntie, they have also got a huge investment into the company. Cousin brother, he has also got the huge investment to the company. And the decisions of Raju and Monu, every time influenced by the uncle, auntie and cousin brother. It means we can say that indirectly they are taking part into the management of the company. Can we say that this uncle, auntie and cousin is also a director of the company? Now we have to understand what's the definition of the director exactly given to the Companies Act. What's the definition of the director is given? If we are talking like a layman, then we can just say that the director is a person who is running the company, who is taking part into the management of the company. If the company's management is being run by a certain person, then that certain person is called, of course, the director. And collectively, these people shall be called as, of course, the board of director. So do we have to come onto the definition of a director? How the director has got to be defined, only after that we should be coming on to this particular story that, you know, see how the director has been defined under the Companies Act 2013. Let me explain this point at first, how the director has got to be defined there. I'm just putting the bare act before you, notes before you, and here it's written that, you know, director means, see what's written that, director means, see, whenever we are saying the means, see, two kinds of definition may be there. Either the definition starts with the means, or definition starts with the word include. If the definition starts with the mean, the definition is exhaustive definition. It means that you can't make any further addition on that particular definition that you have. Then here it says that director means that a director appointed to the board of director. A director appointed to the board of director. If Narayan Murthy says that I am taking the retirement from the Infosys, if Narayan Murthy says I am taking the retirement from the Infosys, and he had just taken the retirement from the Infosys, but still the board of Infosys is being influenced by Mr. Narayan Murthy. Can we say that Mr. Narayan Murthy is the director of Infosys? Answer called no. He is not appointed right now. Until you are appointed, you cannot be called as the director of the company. Appointment is very much necessary. Whether it's appointed by the board of director, whether it's appointed by the shareholder, and whether it's appointed by the central government, you know, appointment word is very much necessary. So if here we are moving on to that point, you know, onto the same definition here, that what you may say that here, can this Sonu, Monu and Raju be called as the director of the company? Answer called yes, they can be called as the director of the company. Can this uncle, auntie and cousin be called as the director of the company because the decisions of the Raju and Monu is being influenced by these people? The answer called no, because they are not appointed as a director into the company. They will only be considered as, of course, the member of the company. There won't be any problem at all, you know. Now coming to the definition once again here, what's written here? Once again, we are coming to the definition. See what it says that. So then the definition of director is very much exhaustive. And there is the requirement to put out the exhaustive definition of the director into the Companies Act 2013. If we are talking about the Companies Act 1956, at that very time, there was the inclusive definition of the director. And it was said director includes whosoever occupying the position of director. It means if we are talking about the Companies Act 1956, the appointment was not very much necessary. If you are functioning as a director, even in that situation, you shall be called as the director of the company. But nowadays, the matter has got to be changed. Although you are functioning as a director into the company, you are influencing the decision of the company, even though you cannot be called as the director of the company, but vice versa. If you are appointed as a director of the company, you don't take part into the management. Nevertheless, you are coming to the board meeting. You don't interfere into the decisions of the other directors or the board, even though you shall be called as the director of the company, since you have got to be appointed as the director of the company. So there is a huge difference between the Companies Act 1956 and Companies Act 2013 in respect of the definition of the director. Where the definition of the director in the Companies Act 1956 was inclusive, here it's the exhaustive definition. Why this drastic change? The reason is there. In the Companies Act 2013, each and everywhere, at lots many places, it was specified a word fine, a word imprisonment. The fine is not for a lesser amount. It may go up to 25 lakhs. Such a huge fine you cannot impose onto the person on the basis of just a fact that your decision may influence the company. You can't put such a fine on the basis of only the facts, you know. Until the person is appointed
these kind of fines cannot be imposed on the person. That's why the definition is just focusing on the word that, you know, director means a director appointed to the board of the company. That is called section 2 clause 34. And if we are talking about the commentary here, I have already explained that, you know, the definition of director is an exhaustive definition, and a person shall consider as a director shall be considered as a director only if he has been appointed as a director by the company. If a person only functions as a director but is not named as director, he shall not be regarded as a director. This one, the point called here. What's called to the board of director? If we are talking about the board of director, if you're talking about the board, then it means director collectively may be called as, of course, the board of director. Means a collective body of the directors of the company. See, this is Mr. A, Mr. B, Mr. C, and Mr. D. These four people are the director of the company. Then collectively we may say that it's the board of director. It's a board of director. Board of director is a duly constituted body to direct, regulate, supervise the company. And all the powers, whatever given into the Companies Act, you know, all the powers, whatever given into the Companies Act, powers given to the company, we can assume that this power is given to the board of director. Means we can say that if somewhere is written that this thing can be done by the company, then we can assume that this thing can be done by the board of director. Because the company has not got its own eyes, its own mouth, its own hand, its own legs. The company has to work on the by the ears of the director, by the eyes of the director, by the mouth of the director. So whenever we are saying that this power has got to be given to the company, either in the Companies Act, either in the other act, either in the Articles of Association, then our prime assumption will go that, you know, the power is given to the board of director. This one. And if you are talking about the board of director and board, there is no difference between that. These are just the synonyms here. They are just the synonyms. What's the need for the director? Because the company has separate management and ownership. Management is separate. Ownership is separate, you know, and company, since capable of enacting of its own, that's why they are working with the hands of the director. And we can say that to fulfill all the legal requirements, it is very much necessary for the company to appoint a director to the company there. Apart from that, if we are specifying the kinds of director onto the very basic, then we have seen two kinds of director. The one is the executive director, the second is the non-executive director. Executive director is just a whole-time director. It may be the managing director who works into the company. He has got his regular duty. He will come to the office. He will participate into the decision making. He will put out his brain onto the performance of the company. He will do everything for the company. He won't do any other job. He is full-time dedicated to the company itself, you know. This one. That may be called, of course, the executive director. Just for example, we may say that Mukesh Ambani, Ratan Jhunjhunwala, these are such a people who are the executive director of the Reliance Industries Limited. But still we have got non-executive director. Non-executive director. Non-executive director, they will just come to attend the board meeting only. They won't take the participation into the day-to-day management. They don't come to the office and they will just attend the board meeting. For example, Shah Rukh Khan is the director in G Limited. That may be. And you may say that Amitabh Bachchan is the director in Adlabs Limited. So these are such a people who are just a non-executive director of the company. But if we are talking, if you're saying that director, the word director only, it means both executive as well as non-executive director, both. There won't be any problem. It's considered as, of course, the both executive director as well as non-executive director. This one the matter called here. That was the point.
So director who are not in the employment of the company, they are just called non-executive director. Or here it includes the nominee director, or it may includes the part-time director. This one the point called here. This one the point called here. And so right from here, we are going to start the provisions, whatever content into the director. And the provision of director contains under section 149 to 205. We may start our class right from the beginning, what it called section 149, but I think better to start our class from section number 164, because 164 just says here that disqualification of director, it means that firstly we have to examine whether this person is eligible for being appointed as a director or not. If he is eligible, then we shall proceed with him. If he is not, then we shall not proceed with him. So our first class is going to be starting by the provision called section number 164. Thereafter I shall do that section number 167. Thereafter section number 165. Some basic series will go like that. Thereafter 152 to 159. Only after that we shall catch up our series section number 149 onwards there. This one. Nevertheless, you have to worry about the law. Everything I will manage. I will tell you how to score 70 plus in law. The prime fundage only. You just attend the class very properly. If you are attending the class very properly, then there won't be any problem. Each and every concept, your each and every concept would be cleared. There is no scope of rectification into the law. Each and every provision I will set out in your mind. Each and every sections I will establish in your mind. After the class, every day you will say that, yes, I remember the section, I remember the provisions, whatever the questions are coming, I'm able to solve it out. So patiently attend the class and we shall be having, of course, a very nice result. So let us continue with section number 164. And one more thing I must say you, that you have to subscribe my YouTube channel, so that if there is any new happenings, new venture, my new experience, I could share with you. Okay, let us start section number 164 onwards there. See the topic. Now we have to see the disqualification of director. It means section number 164, what it called disqualification of director. See why we have to study this particular provision and what's the use of this provision in our practical corporate life there. See, if one person is coming down here to ex-limited saying that I am having the 70% shares of the company, please appoint me as a director. He has given the special notice to the company for being appointed him as a director of the company. Can the company appoint him as a director? Now the question comes, whether he is qualified for being appointed as a director, whether he is disqualified from being appointed as a director. See, there is no particular qualification of director is given under the Company Act 2013. Nevertheless, the provision says here that the director should be, of course, a graduate or 10th pass or 12th pass, nothing like that, you know. Even an illiterate person can be the director of the company. Even the person is resident of India or resident outside India, there is no matter. Whether he is Indian resident or NRI, there is no matter. He can be appointed as a director of the company. There won't be any problem. What we have to see? We have to check section 164. We have to check section 164. Whether he is disqualified under section 164 for being appointed as a director of the company, we have to see section number 164. See, 164 has got to be divided in three parts, and I am specifying, I am giving you a brief introduction of all these three parts, what's how the section 164 will go, that you know, this is of course the matter we have to see. You see, I am just giving a brief coverage at first. We have to see section number 164, subsection 1, section number 164, subsection 2, and section number 164, subsection 3. See, 164, subsection 1, it just given the nine grounds of disqualification. Here, we have got two grounds. Here we have got two grounds, and here it's for private company. Company, any extra ground, whatever the private company provides in its articles, whatsoever a private company provides in its articles of association. See, these are the coverage of section 164 which we have to see that. So one by one we must see section number 164. See that first, these nine grounds of disqualification. I am putting the book onto you. Let us see what is given there. First, section 164. It just simply say here that, see what is written there. Disqualification for appointment of director. The provision says that a person shall not be eligible for appointment as a director of a company. As a director of the company. Here is disqualification just for the appointment of director. Here the first point says, he is of unsound mind. Of course, unsound mind. Firstly, I am just giving the introduction of all these points. Later on, of course, I will explain everything, you know. Let me put on an introduction of all these nine points there. First, it says that, you know, unsound mind. Second, if he is an undischarged insolvent, or he has applied to be adjudicated as an insolvent and his application is pending. That was, he's applied means these two points just goes to the insolvency. Point D, it says that he has been convicted by a court of any offense, whether involving the moral turpitude or otherwise, see the point, and sentenced in respect thereof to imprisonment for not less than 6 months, and a period of 5 years have not elapsed from the date of expiry of the sentence. I just making the introduction only right now. He is convicted. He has been convicted for any offense, what it called, whether the offense of the moral turpitude or otherwise. I am just coming to specify the meaning of all these things. No. And next part, it says that an order disqualify him for appointment as a director passed by the court or tribunal. This one, the order disqualified by the court itself, you know. And F, his calls are outstanding. He has not paid the calls on his share. And one more thing, this one, he has been convicted of offense dealing with the related party transactions under section 188. That's called, of course, the related party transaction. And one more thing, it's specified here that, you know, he has not complied section number 152 subsection 3, and 152 subsection 3 related with the director identification number. If the person has not taken the director identification number, he is just disqualified from being appointed as director of the company. I should write, of course, the DIN. And he has not complied with the provision of section 165 subsection 1. It is newly added provision. It's added under the amendment of Companies Amendment Act 2019, where it was added there. See, these are the 9 points in which, these are the 9 grounds on the basis of which a person is just disqualified from being appointed as a director into the company. These are, of course, the 9 points. So let me explain all these 9 points very properly, but if you want to remember all these 9 points, then I must give you some point. You must remember that CID, they are doing a very daredevil work, has gone to ICU, might be some accident occurred, and in ICU, who provides the treatment? Some doctor will provide the treatment to CID. He refers that, C refers that, convicted, I refers that, insolvency applied, D refers that, disqualified by court, I refers that, insolvency adjudicated, C refers that, calls out a standing, U refers that, unsound mind, D refers that, D refers that, he has not taken the director identification number, and C, R refers that, he was convicted in the related party transactions. And one more thing, that's maximum number of directors if he has crossed. This is newly added provision in that very case. See, let me explain all the provisions one by one very properly. Then first we are taking up that, he is of unsound mind and stands so declared by a competent court. See the point, how we can take that, how we can consider that particular provision. See what is given here. Suppose that we are having this person, and you might see the activity of this person, how he's doing that, Can this person be appointed as the director of the company? Can this person is appointed, that was, can this person be appointed as a director of the company? Suppose he has come down to the company saying that, I have got 70% shares of the company, please appoint me as a director. Here, the 7 directors of the company are sitting here, and they says, these 5 out of 7 directors says that, we know him personally, he is not a fit person, we have seen his activities just being seen like a mad person, he's just a mad person, we know him personally. He is very much frustrated, he just pick out his mobile and just make a call to you and asking from you, sir, can you please advise, can I be appointed as a director of the company? What shall be your advice? Can he be appointed as a director of the company? See, what is written that? He is of unsound mind and stands so declared by a competent court. Means, if the competent court declares him as an unsound mind person, in that very case, he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. But if society declares him as an unsound mind, villagers declare him as an unsound mind, in that very case, he cannot be incurred under the disqualification of section 164 subsection 1A. He cannot be. Let him declared unsound mind by the court of competent jurisdiction, only after that he shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. See, is there any provision in the law in which a court may declare a person as an unsound mind person? Yes. Going to the, apart from the syllabus, I must give you a basic knowledge on that. There is an act called Specific Relief Act 1963. In this particular act, order number 37 is there. You can use this order number 37. By using this order number 37, an application is being filed to the court for being declaring him for
declaring him as an unsanctified person. Court will examine him. Doctor appointed by the court will examine him. If doctor says to the court, this person is not mentally fit, in that very case, the court may declare him as an unsanctified person under order number 37. After that, that person would be sent to the mental asylum. In that very situation, he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. The doctors will provide the treatment to him. Now the person becomes fit after some time. Can he be appointed as the director of the company? Still not. In the view of the court, still he is an unsanctified person. You have to take a declarative decree again under order number 37. And again, he has to apply under order number 37 to the court. Court will examine him once again. And now if the court finds him, okay, no problem, he is mentally fit.
In that very case, the court will make a declaration that now the person is not an unsanctified person. Now he can be appointed as a director of the company. But until the decree of the court is enforced, which were declared that person as an unsanctified person, he cannot be appointed as the director of the company. In that very situation, he cannot be appointed as a director. So what I say to you, I just say to you, he is of unsound mind and stands so declared by who? And stands so declared by the competent court, stands so declared by the competent court. This is of course the particular matter which we have seen that, you know, section 164, 1, clause A. See the matter. Second point. Coming to the second point. What the second point says that, you know, second point says that he is an undischarged insolvent. Let me explain what's the meaning of this word called undischarged insolvent. What's the meaning of the word called undischarged insolvent? Suppose that he is Mr. Raju. Suppose that he is Mr. Raju. And Raju has got huge liabilities from a bank, and he has taken lots many debt from the bank, and he is not paying this particular amount to the bank. You know what the bank will do? That bank has gone to the court saying everything to the court, and what the court says him that, you know, you have to pay the debt of the bank. He says that, you know, I do not have such a huge amount. Even after selling my all the assets, I am not able to pay the amount. In that very case, the court will declare him as an insolvent person. Court will appoint the official receiver for that person. This official receiver comes and sell out all the property of this Mr. Raju. And whatever the amount comes, this official receiver shall distribute all the amounts between the creditors. This is called insolvency of the person declared by the court. But who has applied for the insolvency? That's creditor. This creditor has applied for the insolvency of Mr. Raju. And on the application of the creditor, the court has declared Mr. Raju as an insolvent person. Once Mr. Raju has got to be declared as an insolvent, he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. This is of course the foremost point. He cannot be appointed as a director of the company. Once he has got to be declared as an insolvent by the court of competent jurisdiction. Now the question comes, for how long he shall be an insolvent person? For full life? For complete life? No, there is a limitation. It will be decided by the court for how long he shall be an insolvent person. Suppose that if court says for 2 years or for 3 years, in that very case, suppose that if court says you are insolvent for 3 years, in that very case, for this period of 3 years, you can be called, Mr. Raju can be called as an undischarged insolvent. After 3 years, he shall not be an undischarged insolvent. Now he is not an insolvent. But during this particular period of 3 years, he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. He cannot be appointed as a director of the company. This is, of course, the matter we got there. That is clause B. Should we come on to the clause C? Yes, with your permission, I am coming to clause C. See the point. You just keep a very proper attention to the books as well as the slides, whatever I am putting on your screen, and just get it properly there, you know. See the point. He has applied to be adjudicated as an insolvent. What is the meaning of the word called adjudicated? Here the word adjudicated means that, you know, the decision of the court. Means he is applying to the court that and saying that, you know, he himself applying to the court and saying to the court that, please declare me as an insolvent. Please give your verdict regarding my insolvency. Please declare I am an insolvent person. And his application is pending. Court has not yet decided whether the person is an insolvent or not. His application is still pending. Here, if the creditor applies to the court for the declaration of the insolvency of the debtor, in that very case, until the decision of the court comes, that debtor cannot be said as, of course, an insolvent person. He can be appointed as a director of the company. But if he has applied himself to the court for declaring himself as an insolvent person, just by making an application, he cannot be said as an insolvent person until the decision of the court comes out. But meanwhile, the period during which his application is pending, in this case, he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. He cannot be appointed as a director of the company. See, I am just putting some very huge explanation on that point. Some more clear explanation I must put on that, you know. Let me put on some very clear explanation there. See the point. What and how I am providing to you. Let us see. Suppose that, you know, this is Mr. Raju has huge liabilities from the bank. He has taken huge loan from the bank. Now the bank is asking, please return our debt. It's very much matured. You have not paid the interest as well. Raju says, no, I do not have the money. I can't pay right now to you. Every day bank is poking him to please pay the debt, but Raju is not able to pay the debt. Then two cases may be there. For recovery of this amount, one may go to the court. Now who is going to the court? In case one, it's Raju. Raju is going to the court. Now you will ask why the Raju will go to the court. Because Raju wants from being escaped from the bank, from the creditor. He wants that the creditor should not bother him. Because he has got no money. Even after selling all the assets, he has got no money. So that he could pay the amount to the bank. That's why the Raju has gone to the court. Asking to the court, please declare me as an insolvent person. Because my asset is very lesser than liabilities. So please declare me as an insolvent. The moment he has put an application to the court, right from that particular time, he is just being disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. Let the decision comes at any point of the time. There is no issue. But once the application is made by the Raju to the court, he shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. But if we are putting the second case, now the bank is going to the court for recovery of its debt. Bank is framing the case against Raju that the Raju has got the lotsmani amount from the bank but is not willing to pay it. What the court will do that? Court will put a date for the hearing in which the Raju will also come. Court will ask to the Raju whether can you pay the debt to the bank? Raju says that, you know, no sir, we do not have any amount, huge amount, so that I can discharge, liquidate all the liabilities of the bank. Then what the court will do that? The court may declare Raju as an insolvent person. Here the disqualification comes right from the date of the adjudication, when the court decides that the Raju is an insolvent person. So what the conclusion? if the person makes the application of his own for being declaring him as an insolvent person, in that very case, he had just disqualified right from that particular day on which he has put an application to the court. But if the creditor puts an application to the court in regard to its debtor, in that very case, disqualification comes when the court decides that, you know, when the court decides that the person is an insolvent person. See, this is the basic difference between the clause B and clause C. Clause B and clause C. Now, coming to that's called clause D. Now, coming to clause D, see the point, what is given onto the clause D. Clause D says here that, I am just putting a very generalized interpretation of that clause D and see what's the relevant point here. He has been convicted by a court. Let me quote all the point, because each and every point very much important there, you know, of any offense, whether involving the moral turpitude or otherwise, right? This one. And sentence in respect thereof to the imprisonment for not less than 6 months, and a period of 5 years has not elapsed from the date of expiry of the sentence. Let me explain the points till here at first, you know. It's clause D. I just put down one provision there. See what says the end, you know. It says that he has been convicted. First, convicted. Convicted by who? By a court. For what? Of any offense. What kind of offense? So whether of moral turpitude, I am writing in short MT, or otherwise. This is the first coverage. Second, and sentenced, it means imprisonment for how many years? No, for 6 months or more. 6 months or more. Plus, now he released now. 5 years. 5 years. That's has not elapsed from the date of expiry of sentence. From the date of expiry of sentence. This 5 years has not elapsed from the date of expiry of sentence. Let me clear this provision very properly. The first thing it says here that, you know, convicted by a court. See, what is the meaning of the word convicted? What is the meaning of the word convicted? Firstly, let me put a question to you. Do you know this person? This is Daud Ibrahim. Right from 25 years, the police is chasing him. He just ran away from police. Now he settled at Pakistan. And what the crime he has committed in India? He is a mastermind of Bombay bomb blast, which was taken in the year 1992. And right from that time, Indian police is searching him. Now, if he puts a call to you, asking you, sir, can I be appointed as a director of the company? What shall be your answer? Can we say that he is disqualified under section 164 1D? Let us examine the provision section 164 1D. whether he is satisfying all these three conditions. If he is satisfying, then very much possible he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. But what section 164.1d says that, you know, section 164.1d says that convicted, he has been convicted. So what is the meaning of the word called convicted? The word convicted means that, let me show you a slide to explain the word convicted. See the matter, what's given there. And I just wrote the matter here. If somebody is involved in any kind of crime, then that person is just being said as an accused. He is just an accused. If somebody is saying that he is the murderer, right now he is an accused. Now the police may arrest that person. That person would be presented before the court, and after number of hearings, what is called trial, the court will come to the conclusion that whether the person is really a guilty or he is an innocent person. Because in the court, the public prosecutor will go against him. Public prosecutor will put out all the evidence, whatever he has got against him, and his lawyer will put out all the evidence, whatever comes in his favor. Now, hearing after hearing, debate after debate, one day will come when the court will conclude that whether the person is a guilty person or an innocent person. If the court finds that the person is guilty, now the court will announce his punishment. Now we say that the person is a convicted person. Now we say it's, of course, the person is a convicted person. If the court finds him an innocent, in that very case, the court will acquit him. Now he will go to his home. He's an innocent person. The accusation was a false accusation. That's the court says here. Now, what the stage of the doubt right now? The stage of doubt right now, he's just an accused here. Let the police find him out. Let the police present him into the court. Let the court decide whether it's guilty or innocent. If the court decides he is a guilty person, in that very case, he just disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. That's the matter we got there. So what shall we conclude that? Can the Daud be appointed as a director of the company? Answer called yes. He can be appointed as a director of the company. The answer called yes. Right now he can be appointed as a director of the company. Now, one more thing. Let me explain here. Convicted by a court at any offense, whether the offense of moral turpitude or otherwise. That was the matter. What is the meaning of the word this moral turpitude? This moral turpitude just means that the crime against society. It is such an offense which will hamper to another. It is such an offense in which a person is getting, of course, the wrongful profit. If such an offense in which other person will get a wrongful loss, probably it may be the offense of the murder, corruption, whatever is the said it may be, theft, robbery, whatever. Whatever the offense prescribed under the Indian Penal Code, all these offenses are just called the offense of the moral turpitude. But torts cannot be called as an offense of the moral turpitude. The torts is just a civil wrong. That was, torts is just a civil wrong. But tort cannot be called as an offense of the moral turpitude. This one the matter called here. So, it is the point. If the person is convicted by a court of any offense, whether of moral turpitude or otherwise, whether the moral turpitude or otherwise, in that very case, that person is just disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. Yet the offense is moral turpitude or otherwise. What is the meaning of the word called otherwise? The word otherwise means called here. It is given under the definition specification rules there. It is given that, you know, it says that, you know, otherwise means Companies Act or Companies Act 2013 or any other previous company law. Even the person has got to be convicted under Companies Act 2013 or Companies Act 1956. And if the imprisonment is there for the 6 months or more, In that very case, he is just disqualified from being appointed as the director of the company for the 5 years. He can be appointed as director only after the 5 years from the date of the expiry of his sentence there. This is the matter called here. So this is convicted by a court at any of any offense, whether the offense of the moral turpitude or otherwise. This one the matter called here. See the point. Conviction is there for 6 months or more. I have already explained it. Provision, the conviction is that for 6 months or more. Let me explain a very particular example on that. Very particular example. I'm just explaining that. What specifies that? And suppose that this is a person, and he just reached to the Connaught Place, Delhi. There is a very important place, very of course demanding place in the Delhi, what it called the Connaught Place. He come at Connaught Place. He has got arms in his hand. He is just beating the people. He is just fighting with the other people. He is swinging the pistol to other people. No. It means he has committed the crime. Police arrested him. Now he has been presented before the court. The guilty is proved now, and court is announcing his verdict. What the verdict given by the court? Court says that you were having an unauthorized arms in your hand. That's why we are giving you the punishment under the Arms Act for 3 months. 3 months imprisonment. Apart from that, you have created a nuisance at the public area. We are giving you the punishment for 2 months. 2 months punishment. One more thing. You have beaten the people. We are giving you the punishment for 4 months. Suppose that this one. It is just an assumed example. He is very much frustrated for me after listening all this imprisonment. Now the police was taking him out. He was just sitting into the police van. You were standing outside the police van. He just seen you. He had just seen you and asking you, "Sir, can I be appointed as a director of the company after coming from the jail?" What shall be your answer? You will calculate this 3 months, 2 months, 4 months. It totals comes that, 9 months. Will you answer? No, you cannot be appointed as a director of the company. No, this is not an answer. Here the answer, you have to see that, is there any crime in which he was convicted for 6 months or more? Answer called no. Because here he had just got to be convicted for 3 months. Here it's for 2 months. Here it's for 4 months. You cannot accumulate all this imprisonment, You cannot accumulate. So the total imprisonment, what it comes that, the maximum imprisonment is 4 months there. So he can be appointed as a director of the company. He can be appointed as a director of the company. He's not disqualified at all, This one. So that was, and sentence in respect thereof to the imprisonment. And a period of 5 years has not been elapsed from the date of expiry of the sentence. This one the matter. You are providing a very nice advice to the person. Your advice is very much famous. Now, one thing very much clear here. There is a person, he is really a convicted person, and making a calls from the jail to you and asking you, "Sir, can I be appointed as a director of the company?" What shall be the answer? Whether yes or no. You asked him the second question. For how long you have been convicted by the court? He says that only for 4 months. Tomorrow I want to be appointed as a director of my company, my own company. Can I be? Then what shall be your answer? Can a person sitting in a jail be appointed as a director of the company? Answer called yes, he can be appointed as a director of the company, but condition is that he was not convicted for an offense of the moral turpitude or otherwise, and sentence in respect of that 6 months or more. If he was sentenced for 6 months or more, in that very case he is just disqualified. But if he was convicted for a lesser sentence, then no matter whatever he was in jail, he can be appointed as a director of the company. There is no issue on that, you know. So till now we have seen 4 points. The first point is very common, very proper. It says that, you know, the person is of unsound mind person, they stand so declared by the court of competent jurisdiction. The second thing is, of course, he is an undischarged insolvent. The third thing is called, of course, he has applied to be adjudicated as an insolvent and application is pending. And the fourth thing is that he has been convicted by a court of competent jurisdictions for the offense of the moral turpitude or otherwise, and imprisonment in respect thereof for 6 months or more, and 5 years has not been elapsed from the date of the expiry of his sentence. These 4 points we have seen till now. See, from more question, I must repeat lots many question on that, you know. I must repeat lots many question. See, this one. Now, accused, coming to clause E. Clause E says here that an order disqualifying him for appointment as a director has been passed by a court or tribunal and his order is in force. I must give you an example of Ramlingan Raju. You might have remembered this name. It's a very famous name. The Ramlingan Raju is the CEO of, was the CEO of Satyam. You might have remember in the year 2009, there was a huge scam revealed against the Satyam in which the prime accused was Ramlingan Raju. Ramlingan Raju was the prime accused on that, you know. He was charged with under section 77A of the Company Act 1956. He was charged with under section 15G of the SEBI Act 1992, offense of insider trading. And finally, the court has given the verdict and he was imprisoned for 10 years. And its order, the court has written that even after the expiry of the sentence, you cannot take any kind of participation into the formation of the company. You cannot be the promoter of the company. You cannot be the director of the company, even after the expiry of the sentence there. So whenever a court finds a person is a fraud person, a person is economic offender, the court may blacklist that person. Court has got the power to blacklist a person from being appointed as a director of the company or promoter of the company or taking part of any kind of participation into the management of the company. If he is such a person, then section number 164.1E says here that he is just disqualified. For what period? It says that the order of the court is in force. Until the order of the court is in force. So until the order of the court is in force, he is just disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. This one the matter. Now, if he wants for being appointed as a director, he has to request to the court that, you know, he will make an application to the court. Point to the ground, the court may remove this particular disqualification. This is clause E. Come to clause F. He has not paid the calls in respect of shares of the company held by him. Let me clean that at first. only after that I will explain very properly there. Clause F. Clause F says that he has not paid any calls in respect of any shares of the company held by him. Calls outstanding. Sometimes a person thinks that I am standing onto the fiduciary position of the company. What matters whether I should pay calls or not? Let the public will pay the calls. My call will be outstanding. I will not pay at all there. That's a very wrong thing. Very wrong thing. If his calls outstanding, if he has got the call outstanding, and this period is 6 months have elapsed from the last day fixed for the payment of the call, in that free case, he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. He cannot be appointed as a director. Suppose, let me put an example. This is person, Mr. A. Mr. A has taken the shares from the company, X Limited. Shares from the company, X Limited. And company has asked a call onto the shares, but he could not pay the call. What are the reason? Whether not willing or could not, there is a different issue. The final issue is that he could not pay the calls to the company. 6 months have elapsed. Now, if he is going to be appointed as a director in this particular company, in that very case, he cannot be appointed as a director because his call is outstanding. Now the question comes, if he pays the call, whatever due onto the shares, after 6 months, whether the disqualification will cease to over, whether the disqualification will be ceased, can he be appointed then as a director of the company after making the whatever the amount due onto the call? The answer comes yes, because at that very time we can't say that the call is outstanding, because the provision only says that, you know, what says that he has not paid any calls in respect of any shares. Once he has paid the calls, the disqualification will over. So what? The call was paid after 6 months. Here it is written that has not paid any calls in respect of any shares. This was the matter of the company held by him. Whether alone or jointly. Now, if he is saying that this is not my individual share, this share was taken by me onto the joint name, me and my friend, I am ready to pay my share onto the call, whatever I have to pay, 50% amount, whatever 50% honor I have got, that's why, of course, the 50% amount I am ready to pay, but my friend is not willing to pay. Then why the disqualification will incur on me? I am ready to pay my part. Then why the disqualification will come to me? But here provision says that whether the shares is jointly or singly, there is no problem. Even if there is the joint owner of the shares, if the call is outstanding, then person is just disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. All the joint owners will be disqualified. Suppose that A, B, C accumulatively taken the shares of X Limited, but call of rupees 5 is outstanding onto the shares. Jointly, they have taken the 100 shares of the company. Per share value rupees 10, it means 1000. Rupees 500 has already been paid to the company. Rupees 500 is outstanding, which shall be paid by all these three people. Now, if the call is not paid for 6 months or more from the due date, in that case, who will disqualify? In that case, the question comes, who will be disqualified, whether A or B or C or all three? The answer, all three shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director of the company. All three shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director. This one, the matter called here. This one. Next. He has been convicted let the time come. I will, of course, take a class onto the related party transaction. Only after that you will be able to understand this particular provision, section number 188. First, you just get a brief idea on that. What it says that if a person is convicted under section 188 at any time during the last 5 years, he just be disqualified from being appointed as a director. This one the matter called here. And H, he has not complied section number 152 subsection 3. You know what section 152 subsection 3? That is director identification number. If you do not have the director identification number, if your director identification number is freezed or suspended by the government, by the ROC, in that case you cannot be appointed as a director of the company. Why this point has got to be added here? There is of course a very basic logic behind that. Why this point has got to be added here? Because in the year 2016 or 2017, the Registrar of Company has struck off almost 3 lakhs companies from the Registrar of Company, they know, due to non-filing of the financial statement. And by making such a provision, by making such a decision, one more decision has got to be taken by the Registrar of Company. Whosoever were the director in that such kind of company, all those directors were put disqualified under section 164 subsection 2, this one, for non-filing of the financial statement or annual return. That which it means collectively almost 10 lakhs person was disqualified under section 164 subsection 2, this one. And after making such a decision, the din of all the directors has got to be suspended by the Registrar of Company itself. All the director identification number has been suspended. This one the matter called here. This is a very huge matter. Very, you may say that, you know, serious matter. If your din is suspended by the ROC, in that free case you cannot be appointed as a director of the company. This is clause H, has not complied section 152 subsection 3. If a person has no din, in that way, case he cannot be appointed as a director of the company. So this is a very serious matter which we have got, you know. One more point has got to be added here under the Companies Amendment Act 2019. And what it says that, I'm just putting that point what is given there, you know. It was just, he has not complied the provision of, that's clause I. He has not complied the provision of section number 165 subsection 1. 165 subsection 1. He has not complied this provision. Section 165 subsection 1 has not been complied by him in that very case. What section 165 subsection 1 says that? 165 subsection 1 says that you cannot be a director in more than 20 companies. If the matter comes for the public company, then cannot be the director of more than 10 public companies. See, if total public and private company accumulatively, you are already having the directorship of 20 companies. And if you want to be a director of 21st company, then in that very case, you are just disqualified. That, you know, you are just disqualified. This is section number 165 concerned here. Let the section 165 come. I will explain a detail on that, you know. So under section 164 subsection 1, we have just seen that 9 grounds of the disqualification. I repeat all these 9 grounds. For remembering all these points, you must remember that Dr. CID, that was Dr. CID ICU. Say it. Right. Dr. CID ICU and this one. D refers that what disqualified by the court. R refers that convicted under the related party transaction. C refers that calls have not been paid. I refers that insolvency applied. D refers that director identification number has not been taken. I refers that insolvency adjudicated. C refers that calls have not been paid. U refers that unsoundment. And one more thing, the newly added provision, section 165 subsection 1, the number of directorship has gone beyond 20 after being appointed as a director into the company. So these are the points called under section 164 subsection, that's 1, in which a person cannot be appointed as a director of the company. Now we have to see one more provision, and I am just explaining one more provision for you there. What's the provision there? Let us see. Now see, we have seen these 9 grounds of disqualification under section 164.1. That's A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and one more thing, H, and one more newly added provision, I. There is a similarity between in the provision called this one, D, and apart from that, E, and G. Can you please let me know what kind of the similarity in these three provisions? What kind of similarities? All these provisions involves the court declaration, court decree. In clause D, the court is giving the sentence of imprisonment for the offense of moral turpitude or otherwise. Here in E, that's a person was convicted under the related party transaction. And in E, the court has disqualified the person from being appointed as a director of to the company. And in G, the court has convicted that person under the offense of related party transaction, what it called under section 188. Suppose that this is such a person who was hampered by section 164.1(d), or E, or G. But he prefers an appeal to the High Court. You know better, if the person has defeated his case into the lower court, then he may go to, of course, the High Court. And if he has defeated the case into the High Court, then he may go to, of course, the Supreme Court. Here the appeal is pending, right now. He was convicted in the lower court. His appeal is pending before the High Court. Can he be director during this particular period? There may be lots many person whose appeal is pending. For example, Asharam was convicted by the lower court, even by the High Court, but his appeal is still pending before the Supreme Court. That's the matter called here. Mr. Lalu Prasad Yadav, he was convicted. He is in jail now, but his appeal is still pending. Can we say that such kind of person be appointed as a director of the company? Let me explain what's the provision there. Let me explain what's the provision and what its provision says there. See, here the provision says that, here, provided that the disqualification refers to in clause D, E, G of subsection 1, shall continue to apply even if the appeal or petition has been filed against the order of conviction or disqualification. That was the matter. So what? The appeal is pending. The person will still disqualified. Still he cannot be appointed as the director of the company. That's disqualification will go. That's the matter called here. This one, disqualification shall continue. So this was called section 164 subsection 1. Now coming to C, section 164 subsection 2. Clear? Section 164 subsection 2. But before going to section 164.2, I must explain section number 164 subsection 3. 164 subsection 3. Here, section 164 subsection 3 says that the private company may provide the extra grounds for the disqualification apart from these grounds, but the public company cannot do so. I need to put out the provision before you, and let us see what's the provision there, and let me explain. That's a private company may by its articles provide for any extra ground of disqualification for appointed as a director in addition to those as specified in subsection 1 and 2 both. I must explain subsection 2. But first I need to specify subsection 3. Can we say that? Suppose that a company is being formed just for the empowerment of women. Just for the empowerment of women. Can they write into its articles of association that only the women shall be the director of the company? That's in articles. We want to put a clause, only the woman can be a director of the company. Can we put such kind of provision? See, if it is a public company, then answer is no. If it is a private company, then answer is yes. The private company can do so. If you want to put out such kind of restriction, you just form a private company, you don't form the public company, because public company cannot add an extra ground of their disqualification. These 9 grounds are just an exhaustive list. They are not an inclusive list here. This one. But for the private company, it is an inclusive list. They may add any extra ground for the disqualification. For example, suppose that a company is being formed for the promotion of the literacy. And promoter wants to put a provision into the articles that only the graduate person can be the director of the company. Can they put out such kind of provision into the articles of association? Your answer would be the same. If the company is a public company, then no, they can't do that. If the company is a private company, in that very case, they can do that. No problem is there. This one the matter. Okay. So this was subsection 3. I need to specify one more thing here. If you examining the provision, section 164, subsection 1, everywhere it is written here that, you know, I need to put out a very serious issue here. He is of unsound mind. He is of undischarged insolvent. He has applied as an insolvent. He has been convicted by a court of competent jurisdiction. Everywhere he has been written there, you know. Even he has not paid the call. Everywhere he is written. Can we say that disqualification cannot incurred upon woman director? This disqualification cannot incur upon the woman director? No, woman director is also disqualified under section 164, subsection 1. As interpretation of a statute says here that he includes C unless contrary is specified. He includes C. Whenever we have to represent any kind of gender, whether male or female, we may represent by he. This is the basic rule of interpretation. So this is also applicable onto the woman director as well. Now see the point. Subsection 2. 164 subsection 2. It's a very serious provision. Be serious on that. You know, lots many questions keeps on coming from section 164 itself, you know. But prior to understanding section 164 subsection 2, you must have certain basic knowledge, certain basic idea about the, what you may say that, normal compliances, what it called, financial statement, and the second thing, annual return. You might have read that provision, section number 137. If I specify, section 137 deals with the financial statement, or section number 92 deals with the annual return. We need to file the financial statement before the ROC within 30 days of AGM held or out to be held whichever is earlier, or here the annual return within 60 days of AGM held or out to be held, whichever is earlier. So let me explain the provision. Whichever is earlier, section 164 subsection 2, I am just putting it out. If we conclude, then due date of AGM is due date of AGM. You might have understand the matter under section 96, where the AGM has got to be specified here. The due date comes 30th September. The due date of AGM comes 30th September. I need to specify. Here I am writing that due date of AGM. If AGM could not take place, 30th September is the due date. It means last date. Right from 30th September, 30 days. It means 29th October. It's due date for the filing of the financial statement. And right of 60 days, that was October and then November. It's 28th November, that's 29th November, that's 28th of November, sorry. Sometimes days may be extended by the ROC. 28th November, that will be the due date of the filing of the annual return. Here is the 137, it's 29 days and 92 days. Earlier there was a provision section 403 in which there was the time extension for the 270 days more. But now that provision has been repealed, and now this is the date onto which you have to file the financial statement or annual return of the company with the registrar of company. Section 164 subsection 2 is concerned with the contravention of these two provisions only there. And what the section 164 subsection 2 says is that if you are the director of such a company which has defaulted in filing the financial statement or annual return for the continuous period of 3 financial year, in that very case we are just disqualified from being appointed as a director for the 5 years. Let me put out the provision at first before you, and after that we are making all the explanation, all the interpretation of that provision there. Let me put the provision at first here. What says that, the provision says here that, it has got to be divided in two parts. The first part is concerned with the financial statement or annual account, and the second part concerned with the 5 things. That's payment of deposit, payment of interest on deposit, redemption of debenture, payment of interest on debenture, and one more thing that, that's redemption of debentures, payment of debenture and deposits, and one more thing, declaration of dividend. These 5 things were there. So first let me explain clause A, only after that we should be going on to the clause B. See what the clause A says. That clause A says that no person who is or has been a director of a company, who is or has been a director of a company, has not filed the financial statement or annual return for any continuous period of 3 financial year. For any continuous period of 3 financial year. See, I am escaping this provision first, and I am directly coming to this one. See, wherever green line is there, you read only this provision at first there. For 3 financial year, no person who is, shall be, starting from no person, shall be eligible to be reappointed as a director of that company. Of that company. It means reappointment is not allowed. Or appointed as a director in other company. For how many years? For a period of 5 years. From the date on which the said company fails to do so. From the date when the said company fails to do so. I'm just putting in very, 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 of course, exact example on that, the case which I got to declare that. Let me have the case that, see what is the point. It says that, see, suppose that Mr. A is a director, that's in X Limited, see, right, or X Limited has defaulted in filing financial statement for 3 years, that is 2017, 18, suppose whatever the year I am taking that, 2018, 19 and 2019, 20. Here it was not filed financial statement, here also not filed, here also not filed financial statement, this one. So it's the continuous three financial year, either financial statement or annual return. So what's the due date to file in the year 2019-20? So due date of the filing the financial statement is that 30th September is the due date of the AGM, and right from 30 days, it means 29th October, that's due date for filing the financial statement. This 29th October was the last date, and right on 29th October 2000, that's 20, you supposed to file that, 2020, that's you need to file that, I am putting with the date as well, date and year also. It means 29th October 2020. You were supposed to file this financial statement, but the company has not filed. So whosoever was the director in X Limited, that was on 30th September, that is the first date of default 2020. Whosoever was the director on this particular date shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director into another company for 5 years, and this disqualification will goes up to 29th October 2025. That's for 5 years, 2025. This for 5 years the disqualification will go. Only after that you can be appointed as a director into the another company whatsoever. Even you cannot be reappointed as a director of your own company. This one, Mr. A cannot be appointed. This one the matter quality. So there is the default, and there is the specific default due to which Mr. A just disqualified. Now see. Now the question comes here. This is the case. Now I am putting certain question on them. Question. Can Mr. A be appointed as director in UY Limited? Answer says no. He cannot be appointed. His disqualification will go for 5 years, but only after 29th October 2025 he can be appointed as a director in any company, no problem. This one. Question. Can Mr. A be appointed as a director in A Private Limited? Again, answer no. Would your answer be different if X Limited would have been a private company? I'm just putting a question. Would your answer be different? Your
answer be different?
Need to answer be different? Be different if X Limited would have been a private company? Answer, no. Our answer would have been the same.
No.
Now see, one more question. What given here? See that this 29th October 2020, this is the date of default for third year, right? Now, suppose that Mr. Claver, a director of X Limited, we have taken the company X Limited resigns on or before 29th October 2020, whether the disqualification incurred upon him as well, whether the disqualification under section 164(2) will incur whether Mr. Craver is disqualified under section 164(2), the answer says no, because he has resigned before the disqualification, before the default comes out. You have to see the last date on which that person was the director of the company. Now see, third question, one more question. Mr. Innocent has joined the company as on 29th October 2020. Will he be disqualified under section 164(2)? Yes, he will be disqualified. Answer, we don't have to go on to the emotion, we just have to see that, you know, whosoever was the director on that of the company on that particular day, only all these people shall be disqualified. The answer is yes. Since Mr. Claver was the director on that date, that's why he shall be disqualified. Innocent has resigned the company. Innocent will not, sorry, Mr. Innocent was the director on that particular date, he will be disqualified. Mr. Clever has resigned the company, he will not be disqualified. These two questions you must keep in your mind that, you know, this one. Question. Mr. Ram Prasad, the director of X Limited, resigned as on 30th October 2020. Whether he is disqualified under section 164 to answer. He has made a delay in putting his paper, I mean his resignation. He will be disqualified. Yes, he will be disqualified. Right now? So these questions you must keep in mind. These are the certain technical questions which may come out on that section 164 subsection 2. These are certain questions, please note down. Can Mr. A be appointed as a director in Y Limited? And answer no. Can Mr. B be appointed as a director in A Private Limited? No. Answer. And one more thing, can he be reappointed as the director in his own company? I must specify one more question. Can Mr. A be reappointed as a director in his own company that is X Limited? Answer no. He cannot be reappointed as a director in his own company. He cannot be reappointed as a director. So this is the condition, this is the situation which we have got, that you know. And then we have seen section 164 subsection 2 clause A. Now we have to read section 164 subsection 2 clause B. Clause B is also providing the same consequence that, you know, if you were the director of such a company. See, again I'm repeating the what's the language of the act says here, that firstly it was just specified. See, what's the language of the act says? That act says that no person who is or has been a director of the company which, see where to read that, you just connect this point from this one, and after reading this you have to read this one. That's the point. So what's given here, no person who is or has been, it means if he has made his resignation after the default, even though there would be no change in the consequence would be the same. See what says here, that no person who is or has been director of a company which has failed to, number one, repay the deposit, this one, repay the deposit or pay interest thereon, this one, the second thing there, redeem its debenture, that's third one, and fourth one, that was pay interest due thereon, and the fifth one is that pay any dividend declared by company. This one. If the company fails to do these five things, number one, company has failed to repay the deposit accepted by it, they have failed to pay the interest thereon, they have failed to redeem the debentures on due date, they have failed to pay the interest on debenture, and more thing, failed to pay the dividend declared thereon. And it's not a simple failure. It's not the failure of 5 days, 10 days, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 5 months, 6 months, 9 months, 8 months, 13 months, 11 months. It's 12 months, that much. Such failure to to pay redeemed continuous for 1 year or more. Then no person who was the director of the company on that date, this one, again it was written that no person who is or has been director of a company which shall be eligible to be reappointed as a director of that company, it means its own company, what it called defaulting company, or appointed in other company for how long? For a period of 5 years from the date on which the said company fails to do so. See, I must let you know that this particular lines are quite similar, which we have read out earlier in clause A. The same line is there. Only thing is that happening has got to be changed here. There was a default of the filing of the financial statement and annual return. And here is the default, five kinds of default. That's a failure to repay the deposit or repay the interest on redeemed debentures. That's one more thing, to pay the interest on debenture, and one more thing that, you know, fail to pay the dividend thereon. Failure of these five things may happen, you know, this one. What it says that the disqualification would go for the 5 years. Disqualification would go for the 5 years. I must explain this point very properly. I'm just putting up an example on that note. Right after that, I will be see what's given there. Suppose that there is the due date of redemption of debenture, redemption of debenture. It's 5th January 2020. Suppose it might be there. Right after that, 4th January 2021 has gone, but still the company has not redeemed the debenture. We have to see this particular date. Whosoever director of the company on this date, suppose these people A, B, C, D, whosoever a director on these days, this director, they shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director in this company. They shall be disqualified from being appointed as a director in this company. See, and that was now. What it says that, no, let us see the matter which we have got it. They are just disqualified. Now the same consequence I shall take that. How long the disqualification will go? So write for 5 years. Write for 5 years. That's it was 4th January 2026. That's disqualification will go till this place. Suppose that the next year also the company has repeated the default. Now still it is 4th January 2021, but still the company 2022, but still the company fails to redeem that debenture. Then disqualification will enhance for one more year. That's called here, you know, 4th January 2027. So long it will be going on. And same thing was happened into the default in regard to the financial statement and annual return as well. So again, if you think that one more particular year the default continues, suppose that still the company has not redeemed the debenture, it has gone 4th January 2023, then disqualification will of course move for one more particular year. This one, that's 4th January 2028, provided the director had not made his resignation. This is the point called here. If the director has resigned meanwhile, suppose that director has resigned on this particular period, in that very case, his disqualification will not, of course, go longer than 5 years. This one, the matter called here. So that was the point which we have got here onto the matter concerned. Same thing may happen into, of course, the matter concerned with the default in regard to the financial statement or annual return. This is such a thing which we have to see that, you know, that's the matter which we have to consider. So Here was the default in regard to the financial statement or annual return. Now one more consequences, I just let you know that, you know, one more consequence I must let you know. See, next point. Suppose that it has gone, it is, what do we say that, there might be the default of section 164, subsection 2, either clause A or clause B happens with the company. Suppose that a company has failed to file the financial statement or annual return for 3 financial year, this one. And suppose that here the company has failed to redeem its debenture or pay interest thereon, or of course what you may say that failed to pay the dividend or pay the dividend or fail to repay the deposit or interest thereon, whatever the whatever the default it might happen, either of clause A or clause B. I just assume a date. Suppose that the date of default, that's due date of disqualification starts from 5th January 2019. See this one. I'm just putting up an example, one case study here. Right from this date, the disqualification, the default is being started. For example, if there is a matter concerned with clause A, then on this particular day, 3 years have got to be completed. Suppose that. Meanwhile, this one person has got to be appointed as a director into the defaulting company. This one. One person has got to be appointed as director into the defaulting company. Will he also be incurred such disqualification? See what happens that, you know, when the company has committed the default of section 164 subsection 2, right after that, one gentleman has got to be appointed as the director in the same company. Will that disqualification will come out on this particular person? What says? What the act says that, you know, let me explain what the act says. Here it's written that it's amendment. Provided that where a person is appointed as a director of a company which is in default of clause A or clause B, he shall not incur the disqualification. Wait, one more thing is written. For a period of 6 months. For the period of 6 months, he shall not incur the disqualification. But right after 6 months, from the date of his appointment, the disqualification will come down on him. What's the intention of legislature by making this kind of provision? Legislature just wants that, you know, that the person who has got to be appointed as a director into the defaulting company, we are expecting he must cure the default, you know, whatever the return has not got to be filed, he must file it, that, you know, whatever the matter concerned with the debenture, deposits, whatever, he must settle all these things, you know. If he is not settling all these things for 6 months, then again the disqualification will come on to him. He will be also disqualified for the 5 years. But from where the period of 5 years will count for him, right after the appointment, right after the expiry of 6 months from the date of his appointment, only after that this period shall be starting there, you know. So this one the matter called here, this one the point called here. See that much. This point I have already explained to you. A private company may by its articles provide for any disqualification. We have already given to you this one. And this particular point we have already seen. Now see what's the commentary of section 164. One, I must let you know what's the commentary. Commentary is very, very relevant point here, because commentary provides the lots many questions, lots many cases study here. The first thing is that disqualification if unsound mind person turned sound mind. See, the person was unsound mind, now he turned sound mind. Doctor says that you are fit, okay, no problem, you can go to your house. Now he is willing to go to his company and he wants for being appointed as a director of the company. Can he be appointed as a director of the company? What the provision says here that, you know, here the provision says that where a person is declared to be of unsound mind but later on was declared of sound mind, the disqualification ceased to exist. This one. But the declaration must be made by the court, not by the doctor itself, you know. For being disqualified, unsound mind must be declared by competent court, but not by the doctor or by the society. This one the matter. Undischarged insolvent. A person is turned undischarged insolvent when he has been adjudged as insolvent, and that's where until his insolvency is over, he cannot be appointed as the director of the company. Continued disqualification even if appeal was prescribed. Suppose that the court convicts the person under whatever the provision it may be. The person is disqualified under section 164(1)(d), or it may be some other matter like, you know, 1E or 1G. That was three provisions are there where the involvement of court specified. Now, if the person is going to the appeal to the High Court, will the disqualification continue during the appeal? Answer called yes. We have already seen that this disqualification will continue even during the period of appeal. You know, that was. We have already explained the matter concerned with the convicted person, but I just forgot to explain that's disqualification if the person is convicted and imprisoned for 7 years or more, then he shall be disqualified for life. This disqualification cannot be over. This disqualification cannot be finished even after expiry of the 5 years. This is the lifetime disqualification which can never be cured at all. This one the matter called. Meaning of otherwise. What's the meaning of the word called otherwise? I have already explained the meaning of the word called otherwise, and this matter was specified. It's called means any offense in respect of which has been convicted by court, and this one, any offense in respect of which he has been convicted by a court under the Act or under the Companies Act 1956. Rule 21K of the Company's Appointment and Qualification of Director Rules. If calls not paid, we have already explained that point. Disqualification under Section 171, 164(1)(d), (e), or (g). We have seen that point. This one, it says that, you know, shall continue to apply even if the appeal or petition has been filed against the order of conviction. We have already explained that point. Disqualification under Section 164(1) is an inclusive list. It means that if only for the private company, it means that if the private company wants to add some extra ground of disqualification, then it's better they can add. There won't be any problem. But if the public company wants to add any extra ground of disqualification, then public company cannot do so. That, you know, in the same manner, if they want to waive out one or more ground of the disqualification, neither the public company nor the public company can do so. They can't curtail the list specified under Section 164(1), but one private company, this private company can enhance the list whatever is specified under Section 164(1)(d). This one. Now, 164(2) commentary is there. We have already expressed lots many things, you know, here on that note. 164(2), this one. Certain points are there even on Section 164(2). Default for financial statement and annual return. It's not very much necessary that a default of both things could have happened just to come out under the disqualification of 164 subsection 2. Even the default of financial statement or even the default of annual return, and if any one of that default continues for 3 consecutive years, in that very case, the person, the director who was appointed as a director on this particular date shall be disqualified. It's here specified here. Default would be in regard to the financial statement or annual return. For continuous, here is the word continuous. It means that we have got that if 2017, 18, 19, 20, 21. Here is the default. Here is not default. Here is the default. Here is not default. Here is the default. So here the default of 3 years taken place, but it cannot be considered as default under Section 164 subsection 2, because Section 164 subsection 2 requires that the continuous period, this one, in order to reckon whether default is specific in Section 164 has taken place of financial statement annual return, one has to see whether non-filing of any of the document have taken place, any one of document, either financial statement or annual return. If one has been filed while other has not been filed, even this situation will also be considered as default. Suppose you are filing the financial statement every year, but there is the contravention of not filing the annual return. So the person would be disqualified if the default continues for the three financial year. I have already explained that what's the annual return. MGT7 form is required to be filed within 60 days from the date of the AGM. I have already explained you that section 137, in which we have seen that the balance sheet and profit and loss account are required to be filed with form number AOC4. This one the matter called here. And now see, failure to pay the loan or interest on loan does not attract the disqualification, because under section 164 subsection 2 clause B, there was only 5 points, you know, failure to redeem the debenture or pay interest thereon, failure to repay the deposit or pay interest thereon. These are the 4 points, and first fifth point is that's failure to pay the dividend declared by the company. None of the point says there that, you know, a failure to pay the loan or interest thereon. If the company fails to pay the interest or loan thereon, directors cannot be disqualified under section 164.2. This one, even the company is a failure to pay the loan. This one the matter. See the point. One more thing I need to explain the point. X Limited issues the bond. X Limited issues the bond, and due date of the redemption of bond was 6th January 2020, but it has gone 5th January 2021. It defaults of 1 year has expired. Whether the directors are disqualified if the company has not yet redeemed the bond? See, whether the directors are disqualified, what you say is that, yes or no? Answer, yes. How? You will say that the bond was also not mentioned there, only the five things were mentioned. But if I am taking you the definition of the debenture, then debentures defines as like debenture includes bond. It was inclusive definition given to the debenture, and it's referred that debenture includes bonds. Whatever the instrument companies issuing, if that instrument contains the nature of debenture, whatever the name they may call, but for the purpose of Companies Act, it should be considered as debenture only. Hence, if the company is making the default in the redemption of bond, even in that situation, this disqualification will incur onto the director. This one the point. You must keep remember this point as well. You know, this one the point called here. See, something I must explain onto the matter concerned with the, what you may say, dividend. If you read out section number 123, see, if you are reading section number 123, then it is just specified here that when the company is declaring the dividend, see, within 5 days of the date of declaration of dividend, all the amount of dividend shall be transferred to the separate bank account within 5 days, right? And if the dividend remains unpaid or unclaimed for 30 days, then after 30 days, within 7 days, the amount of dividend shall be transferred to the unpaid dividend account. You see section 123 properly, we'll read all these things, you know. And if dividend remains unpaid or unclaimed here for 7 years, in that case it will be transferred to the Investor Education and Protection Fund. Okay, suppose that company has made the default on this point. They have not transferred the amount of dividend to the separate bank account. Whatever says within 5 days, you have to transfer. Whether the director be disqualified under section 164.2? No, it is not the default of section 164 subsection 2. See, I am just writing, not a default of section 164 subsection 2. Here, within 30 days, if the dividend remains unpaid or unclaimed in the separate bank account, then within 7 days of expiry, 7 days of expiry of that 30 days, they need to transfer the amount of to the unpaid dividend account. Here the contravention, can we say it's a default under section 164 subsection 2? Answer no, it is also not a default. The company fails to transfer the amount to the investor education and protection fund. Can we say it's default of section 164 answer subsection 2? Still the answer is not, it's not like that, you know. Then what's the default of section 164 subsection 2 in regard to the matter concerned with the dividend? The default is that the company is issuing the dividend warrant to the shareholder, but it is not, it could not be encashed with the bank because there was no fund into the account. The default is that the company could not make the electronic transfer of the funding to its account of the shareholder. The default is that the whatever the check sent by the company to the shareholder, the check got bounced. So these things are called the default, you know, if the money is not paid to the shareholder. See, the amount has not been transferred to the unpaid dividend account or to the separate dividend account or to the investor education protection fund. Although these are the default of 123, but this is not the default of section 164 subsection 2. Owing to this, the director shall not be disqualified if they have committed such kind of default only. This one the point. See, certain duty of director. Duty of director. Let me explain. Duty of director. See, where if default was made by company, if default under section 164 2 was made by the company. And one more thing, duty of director, we need to see. I am just finding out here, we should be writing here. Duty of director, duty of company. Duty of director and duty of company. We have to see the duty of both the people. What's the duty of the director and what the duty of company if the default was made under section 164 subsection 2. Let me explain what's the duty of both the people. First, duty of the company. The company is required to file a form called DIR-9 to the ROC. Company will file form to the ROC. What the name of the form called here? Form DIR-9 to ROC. This form is required to file. The companies are immediately file a return in the form DIR-9 to the ROC. This one, the point called here. And registrar will open this file form for the public inspection. And what's the duty of the director? Director will file DIR-10. This one. No, see, duty of company. Duty of company. See, when this duty requires, if company has committed the default under section 164-2, maybe the default of non-filing of financial statement or annual return or dividend deposit debenture, whatever the kind of default, if the company is committed, then company is required to inform the matter to the ROC in the form called form number DIR 9, form DIR 9. This form is required to be filled to the registrar of company. And one more matter I must need to verify for you: duty of director to be appointed. See, if somebody is coming to be appointed as a director of the company, no matter of the default year, the person, the candidate has to file the form ROC, form DIR 8 to the ROC. DIR 8 to the ROC. It means director to be appointed, self file director to be appointed. They self file form DIR 8 with the registrar of company. This one. It is the duty of director of the company. Every director in a company shall file DIR 8 before appointment, and before he is appointed or reappointed. In both of the situation, you need to file form number DIR 8. So DIR 8 is required to be filed by the director, not the director. Director to be appointed. Before the appointment, they need to file this form DIR 8. And DIR 9, if the company has committed the default. And one more form is there, that's called here form number DIR, that's 10, DIR 10, this one, DIR 10. DIR 10 is applicable for the removal of disqualification. See, if the 5 years expired, or any of the disqualification is removed, in that case you can file the form number DIR 10. You can file the form number DIR 10. This one, the matter called here. That much. Non-applicability. Section 164.2 is not applicable onto the government company. Section 164.2 is not applicable on, I must need to specify, government company. Onto the government company, section 164.2 is not very much applicable. This one, auditor's report. And one more thing, that, you know, what's the matter concerned with the auditor's report? And there is given under section number 143, that's 3G. See, it's written that auditor has to mention that whether any director is disqualified from being appointed as a director under section 164.2. It means auditor will look out the directors of the company. Auditor has to see that whether any director is disqualified under section 164.2. Suppose that this person is a director of the our company called X Limited, which is being audited by the auditor. Now he is also a director in Y Limited, and Y Limited has committed a default, but he has not made his resignation. So what the auditor will do, that, you know, the auditor will mention the matter onto the report. Still there is a director in the company who is disqualified under section 164 subsection 2. So auditor has to mention the matter into the report there. This one. Because whosoever is a director in such a company who has committed a default under section 164.2, the section 167 also says that all that people, all that concerned director is required to vacate all the offices, you know, all the offices of director, whatever he has got till now. We shall read that matter under section 167. Let the time come, we shall discuss that matter. MCA clarification. See, MCA has advised to all the person who was the director of the company. MCA says that if you are disqualified under section 164 subsection 2, then you should not sign any of the forms, whatever to be filed onto the ROC. You don't need to verify, you don't need to certify any form, anything whatsoever. If you are doing that, then all these things shall be rejected by the registrar of company without prejudice to the consequence, whatever is specified under section 164 and 167. You shall, your form shall be rejected without prejudice to the section 164, 167, 448 and 447. It means whatever the fine, whatever the penalty, whatever the consequence is specified under these provisions that must incurred on you, even though of course you are all that consequence whatever is specified under section 164, 167, 448, 447, all that fine, imprisonments, whatever, all these things are incurred on to the director who has certified the forms even after being disqualified under section 164 subsection 2. Apart from that, the form shall similarly be rejected by the registrar of company. This is of course the MCQ clarification which we have got, you know, that much.